All right, so we're live on the Jfokus stage, and I'm joined by Kirk Pepperdine, who just finished writing an upcoming article for Java Magazine.
I did?
Yeah, apparently.
Awesome.
Apparently somebody TR'd it as well and, you know, found some code issues with it, but we'll get there.
Sorry, what are you saying here?
So, Baruch is appreciating that we have upgraded our speaker lineup by replacing Attila with Kirk Pepperdine here at Jfokus.
Attila is, that's a hard act to follow.
Yeah, he is, but fortunately he's after you.
Oh.
So you're not following him, you're preceding him.
Okay, well, I'm warming him up.
You're warming the stage up.
Yeah, okay. Attila, you can thank me later, wherever you are.
All right, so let's talk a little bit about the article which you wrote. So basically what you were doing was you were making a case for how you do performance profiling with lambdas. Basically lambdas versus fork join, and looking at the characteristics of parallel processing and lambdas.
So let's step back and maybe talk about it a bit. And one of the things that I always preach is, you know, like measure, don't guess type thing, right?
Yeah.
And one of the questions we always get is like,
I think that's trademarked. That's a Kirk Pepperdine trademark.
It's now completely trademarked. Yeah. Sorry, guys. the whole idea behind that, we came up with that in a first slide deck, I don't know, 2003 or something. That's quite, we've been saying this for quite some time. It's the obvious thing to say. So the only reason I have it trademarked is because I think I was old enough to actually beat everybody in the time lottery for it.
Yeah, there you go.
There you go. Okay, anyway, so that aside. So the question is, with thread, you know, pools, right? Thread pools, work queues, all of these wonderful things that, you know, that were basically, you're sitting in a queue waiting for something to come along and actually service you. And the question is, it's always been, you know, well, how do you tune these things?
Yeah.
Right? And in the JDK, there's really no way to get good information out of these things to understand how you might tweak these or tune them in order to get better performance out of your system. And so I've written actually a few articles on this whole thing that, you know, if you want to know how to tune something, then basically you should understand how it's being used, how it works and how it's being used. And then you can probably get a good idea as to how to adjust it for your particular workload. And and that's really no different with this article here, except for really what we're tackling is the common pool within fork join, or in fork join in general. It's like, you know, how do you actually get metrics out of the fork join to decide if you need to do something to, or you should do something to adjust the number of workers.
Yeah, well, I mean, this isn't something new. It's been around since Java 7, but I think the reason why this is particularly relevant now is because a lot of people...
And streams.
Yeah, they're going to be using streams and parallelizing things, and they won't even realize what the performance implications are, positive or negative, of turning on parallelization.
Okay. Well,
and there's
I mean,
not a good way to measure that currently.
So let's step back again, right? Yeah. I think that one of the issues is that... Sven's over there. one of the issues is that a lot of people don't even realize what happens when you have a collection and all of a sudden you say parallel stream this thing, right? They don't realize that, you know, that's an implicit call to fork join. And then, you know, and if you got that part, then, you know, maybe you're lucky enough to have worked out, because no one really talks about it, hidden thing, that fork join works off of a common thread pool.
Yeah.
Okay. And the thread pool is, like all other thread pools, it's bounded in size. And you necessarily want to to have an upper bound on the size, because if you just let it go willy-nilly, I mean, you're going to end up...
it causes different system resource constraints at that point.
Well, you end up thrashing, and then all of a sudden your performance goes to hell in a handbasket, as they say. Oh, I'm warming up the crowd for you, Attila. There you go. Okay. So, yeah, the performance goes to hell in a handbasket. So we need to basically understand what is our constraining resource, and then we need to bind. We need to do something so that we don't throw more than that amount of load at it, so that we don't get end up in the situation where we're thrashing and we spend up, you know, a lot of our latencies are now overhead, dead time, and things other than getting our work done.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's really it, you know?
Yeah, so I think one of the interesting things about the article was you also introduced a framework for measuring what's happening inside a fork join by doing some instrumentation. So you had an open source project where you are...
And Martin Vorberg graciously decided to put that up on Adopt and OpenJDK GitHub site, so you can go and find it. And right now the code there is very rudimentary. It took me... I'll have to admit that reading Doug's code was... challenging. All I can say is I'm very happy that Doug's code works, because
you don't like writing slightly esoteric code that's already been run through a mental optimization loop.
Let's just say that I'm very happy that the code actually works, because I think that it would be challenging for even the best of us to sort through and actually figure out how it works. So, I mean, you know, one of the challenges, not really a problem, it's a cool thing, is like one of the challenges is that fork join is like an all hands on deck algorithm, right?
Yeah.
So when you put a task in there, it's like all of the threads are going to take a chunk and start crunching away. So by definition, if you throw one job in the thread pool or in the work queue, your thread pool is now completely exhausted. And you know, so if you throw two in there, it's like, now what happens, right? And, you know, making the thread pool under these conditions bigger just means that, assuming you have sent it enough, a big enough initial work load, that it's just going to consume twice as many threads to get that workload done. So, I mean, it's a beautiful thing. Unfortunately, it makes it kind of difficult to decide, like, what does the size of this queue need to be in order to be effective for all of the different types of workloads that we're going to get across?
Yeah, and like you said earlier, it depends a lot on the application and what you're actually trying to do with the...
Right. So we need metrics.
Yep.
And we need a little bit of math. And, you know, a little bit of math, right? And basically math that we can see in our everyday world, which is how do queues work. So it's a form of a queue. It's a system, and so that's Little's Law. And so there's a little bit of an explanation, hand-waving explanation as to Little's Law in there. And you know, whether it applies or not in this case is a little bit...
Yeah, so I think probably the biggest takeaway, at least for me, for the article, is it provides a framework where you could actually take a look at your own application, reasonably have a methodology where you could understand what's going on and profile it, and then start to draw some...
Right. In
measurements,
case,
which
in,
you can...
In this case, we instrumented it to get the things that you need to plug into formulations that would actually allow you to see what's happening in the queue, what your service times are, what, you know, how many, you know, how often are they being submitted, and that information I think is being used to, you can use it to maybe make rational decisions about how big this thing needs to be.
Cool. Yeah. All right, so looking forward to the upcoming article in Java Magazine?
Yeah, I am. Actually, I've already read it, so. But I'm happy to get comments on it.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, I think you've already read it also and everything. Yeah. So I'm right, happy to comments.
Sven is looking forward to
it. Sven is looking forward, yes, Sven. You know, if you want to make the code base in there a little bit better. I know that we need to write a spec and everything like that. So really, you know, call to arms. Let's help Doug instrument his code so that we can get metrics out of it, so that we can really understand.
Very good. We even have a call to action to help improve the OpenJDK code base.
Right. So yeah, and none of my code in there is sacred. You can throw it all away if you got a better way of getting this done. But basically, we use JMX instrumentation to get data, and let's have some fun. Yeah.
Cool. Okay. All right, so thanks for taking some time, Kirk.
And thanks for letting me take your time.
All right.